Welcome everyone. I am Pramod Beesal, IIT Delhi graduate, and today we are going to look at robot classifications. Okay, so we are basically going to divide the robot based upon the mechanical configuration, and then based upon their degrees of freedom, and then based upon their actuator system. Okay, so let's first start with the robotic classification based upon mechanical configuration. Okay, so mechanical configuration basically means what is the configuration of their links and how the links are attached with each other, what sort of work volume it will have. All these things we are going to discuss under this particular classification. Okay, so the first and the basic classification would be that of a Cartesian robot. Okay, so we will simply call it as Cartesian robot. So as we have Cartesian system, that is X, Y and Z, all three perpendicular coordinates, similar sort of configuration we will have for a robot also. Okay, so what exactly do I mean by that? How exactly will that look like? So let's make a diagram for that one. Okay, so there will be one link over here. Okay, so let's say there is a link here. Okay, and then there is a slider here. Okay, so it can slide through this particular system, right? Okay, so there is one link which can slide through this one, and then there will be another link over here. Okay, okay, so we will have another slider mechanism in this side also that can give a sliding mechanism to us again. Okay, so these three links we will be having here. So let's say this is our base in which the first link is. Okay, so this is the configuration that we will have for a Cartesian arrangement or the XYZ arrangement. Now, how exactly does it work? So this particular link is fixed, but this box can slide in this vertical direction. Okay, so we will be having basically our Z movement here. Now, then this link, that link number two, can again slide in this direction. Okay, so we will be having this linear motion again. So two linear motions, and then again this particular link, the link number three, can again slide within this box. Okay, so if even if these two links are fixed, this one can slide, so we are having this third motion also possible here. So basically what we are having here, we have three prismatic joints. Okay, and they are giving us three linear movements. Three linear movement. Linear means, three sliding moment. Okay, three sliding moments we are having, out of which now this particular joint, because this link is in vertical direction and the motion is also vertical, so this is a linear joint. Okay, now this one here is a orthogonal joint, and this one here again it is a orthogonal joint. Okay, so what system we are having here? L O O. So we can represent it by L O O, or we can say that this is a 3P system, is three prismatic joints, or linear, then orthogonal, then orthogonal. That basically gives us the working, but 3P is fixed for a Cartesian system. Okay, so if we are having a Cartesian system, XYZ system, then we are gonna have a 3P system over there. Okay, now a special part of Cartesian system is also known as gantry type of robot. Okay, gantry system, when we give extra supports, extra support to the link. What do you mean by that? If our links are in cantilever system, then that will be simple Cartesian, and if they are having more number of supports, maybe two supports and three supports, like if I can give one support over here for this particular link, then it will be called as a gantry type of robot. So gantry is a basically part of this Cartesian system only. Okay, now this can carry high payload values because of the rigidity of it. Okay, rigid structure is there, so it can carry a higher load carrying capacity it will have. Okay, it can have higher accuracy because less number of joints, right? And then the operation is quite very simple. XYZ, we are very much familiar with the XYZ system. That is why a simple operation, lesser cost. The only thing is that it will require larger volume to set up all this links and joints. Okay, so that is all about the Cartesian configuration of the robots. Now, second that we look at again, when we see in coordinate system, so there is one Cartesian coordinate system, XYZ. Another one is cylindrical coordinate systems, right? So what we will have cylindrical coordinate system? So that is basically cylindrical robot. Okay. One more thing, the work volume here will be X, whatever you call it. Let's say this is my X, this is my Y, and this is my Z. Okay. So finally, the work volume that I'm having here, the points that can be reached by this particular robot is in the form of a cuboid. Okay. X, Y direction, mein, X direction, mein, Z direction, mein, I can move it and I can have a cuboid sort of work volume. Okay. Now let's look at a cylindrical robot. What do we mean by a cylindrical robot and how exactly will that work? Okay. So for a cylindrical robot, basically, I'm going to again give the diagram over here. Okay, so one vertical link basically we will be having here, and that link is going to give us a twisting moment. Okay, so we have fit it into some sort of base. Okay, but it can have a twisting motion over here. Okay, so that motion is possible here. Okay, there is a joint basically that we have given to it at the base. Okay, now there is slider mechanism in between. Okay, and we can have one link over here, then extra link that we can slide in the horizontal direction. Okay. So this second link we are having here, which can basically slide in this particular direction. Okay, so it can have a horizontal sliding direction. Okay, this is our one link, and again we can have one sliding motion in between also. Okay, so basically what all motions are possible here, so this can slide along this one, this can slide in this direction, and this can twist from over here. Okay, so what we are having basically, that we are having two prismatic joint and one revolute joint. So two, in order to give us a cylindrical type of work volume, we will have two prismatic and one robotic joints, one this revolute joints. Okay, and this is a T, means the twisting joint. Okay, this is a linear joint. Okay, and this again is an orthogonal joint, right? So basically here we are having a TLO. See, this is fixed for a cylindrical robot, but this can be some other configuration as well. The only thing that we need is these coordinates. The radius we need for a, this one, okay, we need a Z to give the height, and we need one angle. That is the basic concept behind a cylindrical Cartesian system. Just like in case of a robot, we this Cartesian one, we had XYZ, okay. So we had all these three lengths over here, right? So this three prismatic, that is fixed, that we need to have 3P, but this is just one configuration for that one, LOO. Similarly, 2P, 1R is fixed over here, and TLO is just one sort of configuration that is possible here. Now this O, this is basically giving me the radius, this is giving me the height, and this is giving me angle. This angle may not be 360 degree. Okay, so we may not have a complete 360 degree revolution possible over here. In that case, we may have a half cylindrical work volume. Okay, so yahan pe jo work volume hamara banega, that will be in cylindrical format. Okay, that is going to be my work volume over here. Fine. Now when we talk about a cylindrical one, okay, so that's it. Now next one is our spherical, right? So the third coordinate system that we usually have is a spherical coordinate system, right? So we will have a spherical robot, which will otherwise also known as polar robot. Okay, so just like a polar coordinate system, we are having this spherical coordinate, this polar robot also here. Okay, so again in polar robot, I can simply say that there are going to be 2R to give 1 phi, 1 theta, and 1 L. 1P, that prismatic joint, to give me the radius, right? That is what we have in a spherical joint. So let's have one configuration that is possible for this sort of thing. Okay, so let's say there is one link which is attached to the base, and I can have here a twist moment. Okay, so basically a revolute joint is possible over here, so I'm having a twisting moment here. Fine. And this link here attached with another link with again a revolute joint. So as I said, they are going to be two arcs. So one revolute another revolute joint. So that is another link. And here I can have a sliding motion possible. Okay. So there is this slider basically. That can slide over it. It can be open from here. Okay. So this link, this can have whatever stroke that we want to, whatever this movement we want to give it to. Give to it. Okay. So this, there is a one revolute joint, another revolute joint, and there is one prismatic joint. So 2R, 1P. Okay. One twist, another R. We are having R over here, and this is a linear joint. Okay. So TRL basically, that is what we are having over here. TRL type of configuration. Okay. So these are three main, like based upon our simply coordinate system, three configurations of a robot possible. Now let's look at another two very popular configurations of robots. One is known as articulated arm. Okay, so articulated arm we call it. And how will that look like? So in articulated arm, again we are going to have one twist joint at the base. Okay, so one twisting motion will be possible at the base. So there is going to be a, this is our base. This is not fixed basically, right? We are having a joint over here and it can have a twisting motion. Okay, and that twisting motion now will be having more number of revolutions possible. Okay, so these sort of revolute joints we can have in it. So one twist and all other our simple revolving joints. So articulated arm is basically used to mimic the human arm, and we can have all the applications here that we usually do with the human arm, right? So the main application for this one is that we can have very high speeds here. Okay, large work envelopes. Okay, the work envelope for this one is a little complex, so we can usually say that the work envelope would be work envelope or the work volume is similar to human arm. Okay, similar to human arm, that is going to be here. Okay, and the disadvantage for this one is that it will require a dedicated robotic control system with master control, like PLC and all those things we will need to use here to control this particular articulated arm. Okay, and its application, it has huge range of applications like bakery, cutting steel, manufacturing bridges, casting, spot welding, etc. Okay, all these things I am going to tabulate also later, and I am going to provide you that table so you can directly look at the basic properties of these type of robots. Okay, so we are having this articulated arm over here. So this mechanism is basically TR and R type of, and now the fifth and last our mechanical configuration based robot is a SCARA robot. The full form here is selective compliance. Okay, selective compliance assembly robot arm. Okay, assembly robotic arm. So what we are having here basically, that there is a compliance. Compliance basically is equivalent to flexibility. Okay, so when we say compliance, then it is flexibility sort of. Okay, it is equivalent to flexibility. So there is a selective flexibility that we give to a SCARA robot. Okay, it can have a flexibility in some fixed direction only. That is what we mean by a selective compliance. And then assembly means it is mainly used for assembly and disassembly purpose, like a screw tightening maybe. Okay, putting one thing over another thing, that sort of assembly purpose we use the SCARA robot for. Okay, now when we look at the diagram of a SCARA robot or the working of a SCARA robot, then we'll be having, see, there is one vertical link we are having over here. Okay, and this vertical link can have a rotation possible here. Okay, so there is a rotation possible here basically. Then this is another link. Second link we have here. Okay, and it is attached with a third link such that they can again have a relative motion between them possible. Okay, so these are basically attached here with each other, and there is a rotation or the revolution joint between them, and this can have a rotary moment around this joint. Then our third one, sorry, the next one, fourth one, we will be having another link here, and this link can have basically a vertical movement possible, means we are having a sliding joint here. Okay, so there is a sliding joint here, and this is our end effector or our tool or our gripper, whatever we are using for the assembly purpose. Fine. So what all we are having here, this is joint 1, this is joint 2, this is joint 3, this is my base. Okay, and the joint 1 is basically a revolving joint, right? So joint 1 is V type of joint, revolving joint. Joint 2 is a rotary joint, R type of joint, and joint 3 is our orthogonal joint, right? We are having an orthogonal joint over here. Okay, so what do we have in the end is V, R and O, that is giving us the SCARA sort of arrangement. Here we are having this 3 degree of freedom SCARA. We can have 4 degree of freedom SCARA also, and that will have its own configuration. Okay. It is our basic configuration for a SCARA robot, right? And as I told you, that SCARA robot is very important. Other properties of SCARA robot we will study later when we look at the direct or the forward kinematics of this SCARA robot. Fine. And for now, you can only remember that it is usually used for the assembly type of things. Okay, so as you can see that we can have this up and down motion here. Okay, and here if I have a work table here, okay, and if I need to like tighten the screws and all those things, if you want to have, then we can simply do that over here, right? Screw tightening, assembly, disassembly, whatever you want to have, we can do that sort of job here very, very easily. So that is the like main purpose of SCARA robots. Fine. So that was our classification based upon the mechanical configuration only. Okay, we have further classifications also. So let's look at another classification, which is based. So the next classification of robots that we have is based upon the degrees of freedom. Okay, we also have the classification based upon the actuator and the control system also. So based upon degrees of freedom, again, we have three classification. One, when we are having degrees of freedom less than 6. Okay, so as I told initially in our previous lecture that we usually have 6 degrees of freedom for arbitrary position and arbitrary orientation, but if we have degrees of freedom less than 6, then we call that as a constrained manipulator. Okay, so our robot is basically constrained in some degree of freedom, right? So it is a constrained manipulator, right? If my degrees of freedom are 6 only, then we will call that as a spatial manipulator. Okay, spatial manipulator. Fine. Then again, if we have degrees of freedom more than 6, then we will call that as a redundant manipulator. Fine. Redundant manipulator. So that is how basically we define the robots based upon their degrees of freedom. If you look at based upon the actuators, then again we can have hydraulic robotic system. Okay, we can have pneumatic controlled pneumatically actuated robotic system, and then we can have electrically actuated robotic system. Okay, and our next classification and the final classification will be based upon the control system. Okay, so final classification that we have is based upon the control system. So as usually we have learned a lot about control systems till now. So there is one open loop system, right, or open control system, right? And then there can be a second closed loop system, right? So there is a closed loop system that we have for the robots. Okay, so anywhere, whenever we talk about control system, there are two possibilities only. One is open loop and another is the closed loop. Okay, so in open loop, what we basically do, that we don't take any feedback, right? So no feedback is there, right? Like whenever I have given a command to the robot, it will execute that command, and I am not bothered about whether it has executed it correctly or not. So there will be no feedback system in the open loop. Well, in closed loop, what will happen? We will take the feedback and we will compare it with the desired position. Okay, so whatever is the command that we had given and what it had executed. We will compare these two, and based upon the error, we will again give a command. Okay, so that is why it is called as a closed loop. So there is like one command is there, right? We are giving a command to it. Okay, and then it is executing it, and it is giving us some result. Now this result is compared with the desired result, right? And this difference is basically known as error. Okay, and then we will sense this error, and again a command will be generated based upon that error, and this makes it a closed loop. Okay, so that is why we call it as a closed loop control system, whereas in open loop system we don't have this feedback mechanism, right? So the loop is open here. So we are giving a command, it is executing it and giving some result. That is why it is called as a open loop. Okay, so we don't need any sensors here. No sensors for the feedback, right? For feedback we don't need any sensor, which is what makes it a low cost, right? The cost will be low naturally for this particular one. And the type of motor that we used here is a non-servo motor. Okay, either a non-servo motor or we call it as a stepper motor. Okay, that is what we use here to execute our commands. Wherein in a closed loop system we will need to have sensors, right? And that will make it a high cost, or the cost will increase automatically, and we will use a servo motor here. Okay, what is the basic difference between servo motor and a stepper motor? That this works on basically based upon a point function. Point function means the initial point, final point, that's it. It is whereas a path function, sort of. You can just for your understanding, I'm telling this one. So it is a discrete type of mechanism, and it is a continuous type of mechanism. That is what we mean by a non-servo and servo motors. Okay, and naturally this is having a start point and end point only. Here we are having the start point, end point, and whatever the path that we are taking from that, because we are bothered about the error also here, right? That is what we have here. Now, if you talk about the applications of these two, then application of a open loop, where we are only bothered about the initial point and final point, right? So there could be like loading, unloading, right? Loading, unloading is because we are usually not bothered about the location, exact location of putting the load or unloading it. We will simply load it and unload it, right? And like pick and place, okay, that is basically similar to loading and unloading. Okay, we can also use it in a spot welding, because we will just give a command and it will execute it at the desired position. Okay, so spot welding, we may use open loop type of sensors, right? Whereas closed loops are basically applied in arc welding. Okay, because we are doing a continuous welding over there, that is why we are not only bothered about the start and end point. So here the main point was start point to end point, right? Here we are bothered about the whole thing, how exactly it is executing it, right? And also for a spray painting kind of thing. Okay, so in these particular type of jobs we will prefer a closed loop type of robot. So that was the basic classification of robots. So we have seen basically a mechanical based classification, that is configuration. Therein we saw five classifications. In last year, means in 2019, ESE 2019 means, it was asked that write about four configurations of a robot. Okay, so when we are asked about four configuration, we will not include articulated arm in that, otherwise all other four will be there, like XYZ, spherical, and our SCARA, and cylindrical. These four configuration we will write about them. Okay, so that was one question. And after that we saw based upon degrees of freedom classification, actuator based classification, and control system based classification. One thing that I forgot to mention is, in SCARA the work volume or the work volume is in shape of a donut. Okay, or in Hindi, or whoever knows it, maybe medu vada we call it. Okay, so this sort of work volume it will be possible. Tube, basically it's a tube, okay, 3D. Okay, so that sort of work volume we can have with the help of a SCARA robot. Well, thank you for watching the video, and best of luck for your exam.